Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Pierre-François Latère. I'm head of the ICU at St. Luke University Hospital. And the goal of my presentation is to address how to diagnose sepsis in patients with cirrhosis admitted to the ICU. I have no conflict of interest for this presentation. And so taking care of this patient quite commonly, but admitted in such a picture in a setting of jaundice, acute renal failure, encephalopathy, the concern is always the same. Does this patient present with sepsis? And the proposal is the following one on a daily practice. The rule number one should be a patient with cirrhosis admitted to the ICU, it has a sepsis. The rule number two is that any organ dysfunction, including encephalopathy, renal failure, or jaundice, and even bleeding are commonly caused by sepsis. And the rule number three is that unless everything has been excluded and demonstrated, a cirrhotic patient admitted to the ICU has sepsis. And this slide shows here you the incidence of infection in patients admitted to hospital. So not even in the ICU, but to the hospital. And you see that at least a third of the patient or more have infection at the time of admission to hospital. So how to diagnose sepsis in this population? The common diagnosis network includes fever, change in the white blood cell count, tachycardia, tachypnea, organ dysfunction, including confusion, oliguria, change in the hemostasis, increased biomarkers like the CRP. However, in cirrhosis, it is generally common not to have fever in the setting of infection. There's already a change in the white blood cell count because of hypersplenism. They don't have tachycardia. They also often have beta blockers. Confusion or encephalopathy is part of the picture and therefore it's not helping you. Also oliguria or acute renal failure. And the changes in hemostasis by definition are driven by the cirrhosis itself. CRP is synthesized by the liver and it's not helping you potentially, at least in advanced liver disease. Now, if we look at the pattern of these patients, we see here the long list of conditions associated with infection, or at least favoring or facilitating infection. Their natural barrier is altered, including the skin, but also the GI tract with hyperpermeability and ulceration. They have a alteration in the function of their macrophages, so the Kupffer cells in the liver. They also have a chronic balance in between pro-inflammation and anti-inflammation, leading to alteration in the immune response. They also have an alteration in the opsonic activity. They quite often undergo invasive procedure and receive immunosuppressive medication. And finally, they keep on drinking, quite often if malnutrition associated with the risk of infection. Now, a key player in this setting is the gut permeability and the risk of translocation. These patients do translocate more commonly than healthy controls or other critically ill patients. And this is not just bacteria, but eventually bacterial material crossing the barrier. And therefore, this is inducing a constant pro-inflammatory response balanced by anti-inflammation, and this process is worsening with the progression of the disease. And when you end up in decompensated cirrhosis, you quite often see patients with definitely an alteration in the immune response translated into a disbalance in the production of pro-inflammatory and anti-inflammatory cytokines and a reduction in the expression of H. Leydier, known to be associated with an alteration in the response to bacterial invasion. Now, just the baseline characteristics and severity scores should remind you that these patients have a higher risk of infection. The MELD score will not help you in making the diagnosis, but rapidly a worsening MELD score within a couple of days, 1 or 2 days, clearly is associated with a poor outcome. Now, some have proposed to use and determine the acidic fluid, but also the blood bacterial DNA to diagnose infection in these patients. As you see here, using this, it's not really helpful, at least in predicting the outcome. And the one having elevated bacterial DNA in the blood or in the acidic fluid do not have a different outcome compared to the one with a proven spontaneous bacterial infection. So even though DNA is an elegant biomarker, it's in the practice not very helpful to guide you in the diagnosis, at least in the prognosis of these patients. Now, it's important to focus on infection because over the last decade, there's a significant improvement in the patient outcome in the setting of admission to the ICU for cirrhosis. So it's key to focus on and search for infection. Now, others have proposed procalcitonin because less influenced by the liver impairment. And in this study here, they compare alcoholic hepatitis with infection or no infection. These are the baseline characteristics. There's always a difference, already a difference at baseline in terms of severity because of lower albumin and alteration in the hemostasis. But interestingly, procalcitonin was able to differentiate patients with cirrhosis and infection, and this was significant. However, in the same publication, CRP also was able to distinguish patient with infection or no infection. So therefore, it's to see whether PCT is better than CRP in predicting this. Now, others have shown also that, and using here the ROC curve, that PCT has a better predictive value for the diagnosis of infection compared to white blood cell count and the neutrophil count. But in this study, there was no comparison with the CRP. Also, they mentioned that the level of bilirubin may influence the level of PCT. So we should be cautious according to the level of bilirubin to use PCT as the best biomarker. As you see in this slide here, there's a list of biomarkers proposed to diagnose infection and translocation in these cirrhotic patients. We've discussed already CRP. It's cheap. It's not that specific. It's very sensitive and may be elevated for other reasons. Using LPS, so lipopolysaccharides, may be helpful, but it's an early marker, it has a short life, and there are inconsistent results with this. As said before, procalcitonin is a cheap method, but may eventually lack of specificity, however, slightly better than the CRP. Other biomarkers, including soluble CD14, lipopolysaccharide binding protein, may help also the diagnosis, but on a daily basis, these are less studies. They are much more expensive and difficult to interpret in this setting. We've discussed already bacterial and blood and acidic fluid DNA. Even though interesting, there is no good data in terms of validation. So we left with other proposal. Others have said endocan in the circulating, in the serum or the plasma, may help in the diagnosis of infection. As you see here, endocan compared to CRP is significantly more elevated in patients with decompensated cirrhosis and infection, but CRP does the same. However, the distribution of CRP value is much more widespread as opposed to endocan. So the specificity of this biomarker seems to be better. In the same study, they showed that PCT has also a good predictive value as the TNF level, but we know that's on a daily basis. Using TNF is not that easy. So they concluded that endocan has a higher sensitivity and specificity compared to PCT and CRP. Once again, this biomarker is not commonly used, and we have a need of additional data to support this. Now, it's key to address the fact that in the absence of a good biomarker, and anytime there's a suspicion based on organ dysfunction, at least introducing empirical antimicrobial therapy is at least being shown to improve the outcome of these patients. As you see here, patient receiving broad-spectrum antibiotics compared to the standard of care adds a mortality divided by 4 compared to the standard of care. So to conclude, we should always consider sepsis and cirrhosis when the patient is admitted to the ICU. The usual clinical signs and symptoms may be absence or at least not reliable. any kind of patient with a change in the kidney function, I mean renal failure or acute kidney injury, is by definition a patient with a higher suspicion of infection. You should initiate an antimicrobial therapy empirically in the meantime and select antibiotics according to the patient origin. But there is still a need in the future for better, more earlier and specific biomarker to diagnose sepsis in this setting. Thank you for the attention.